was saying with pop singers, you know, is that what we want out of, is that what we want our kids to have? Something cheap and superficial. Never want to write no pop song. What people got out of it wasn't what I was trying to say at all. And so I guess I kind of missed the shot, but I just, it could have been anything. I just said singer because that's what I was. Never had no weird hair to get my songs over. The biggest hamburger company advertises 19 billion sold instead of quality, quantity instead of quality. And that's pretty pop to me, and I don't want to, I don't want to live in a culture like that. Never want to hang out after the show. Quality's got to enter into it sometime. And when I was growing up, there was a big distinction between rock and pop, you know. Rock was more immediate and had more to do with the artist. And pop music was, you know, a guy'd write the song, a different guy'd sing it, and a different guy'd produce it. You know, it wasn't like, wasn't anything real. It was just something to entertain us for the moment. Well, I lived on the outskirts of town. I mean, I love Dylan. Spoke to me a lot. It seemed like I look back and I liked his song. Donovan, you know, he wrote some great songs. Universal Soldier. Don't forget, this is the 60s. I grew up in the 60s. There was Frankie Lyman, Bobby Fuller, Mitch Ryder. They were rockin'. Jackie Wilson, Shangri-La's Young Rascal. They were rockin'. By light of Martha Reeves, don't forget James Brown. Rockin' in the USA. You know, I never was saying anything bad about pop music or anything like that. All I was saying that we have got to start, you know, looking at what's real and what's pop and trying to make the world a little bit more real place to live. There's a difference between Rembrandt and Andy Warhol. I prefer Rembrandt. My wife wanted to buy a painting in Los Angeles, because, you know, our walls were pretty bare in the house, and she wanted to spend a bunch of dough on it, and I said, oh, forget that. I can paint that, surely. So I just had her take a picture of it, and I painted it. It wasn't anything nearly as good as the guy's, but it was colorful. But the best news was that I had a good time doing it.
Yeah, when I was a kid, there was a woman who painted in our neighborhood, and I was like 7 years old, and we broke into her studio and tore up her paintings and squirted oil all over the place and had no idea what we were doing, but I feel pretty rotten about it. Because, you know, the woman didn't want to press charges or anything like that. And as long as our parents were willing to pay for the damages, then everything was cool. So they put us in jail for like 3 hours, all us. There was even a couple gals with us, little girls. And I think there was 5 guys and 2 girls, and we're all standing in jail. 8 years old in jail. Then I got home and got my ass beat. It's the hardest job in the world. There is nothing harder than to paint. I mean, and that's what I like about it, is that I don't think the challenge is ever over with painting. You know, sometimes you know, you have a career and you get to a point, you think, well, I'm doing pretty good in this, and you lose interest in it. First thing, if you show these pictures to people, go, I don't look like you, man. I can already hear that, you know. But like I said earlier, they're not supposed to really look like me. I was just a guy looking in the mirror. You know, it's like, man, I'm painting, don't bother me. I like that. I'm doing what I want to do. But my kids like that paint because I made my gut so fat. Dad, you're not that fat. I will be. Just wait.
To MTV and told his tales of Jack and Diane, and now he's back with a new album full of songs from America's heartland. He called himself the Little Bastard, and we know him better as John Cougar Mellencamp. Come on!
I'm pretty stupid, you know. I do a lot of things that, like everybody else, that we all regret. I came to New York for the first time when I got out of college, and I got hooked up with a guy who said, listen, man, I took David Jones to David Bowie, and I changed his name, and it was because that was one of the reasons he's so successful. So I'm going to do the same for you. Because I went and looked at the album cover, and there was, like, this name on the album cover, my picture, and I was like, who's this fool? About a couple years ago, I realized that people really were listening to what I was saying, and I was making an impression on some people, and I thought, you know, like I said a few years ago, I felt like I had no responsibility to these people at all. I mean, it's like, hey, I'm just a guy in a band from Indiana making records. But now I kind of feel differently about that.
No, I could no more write a song about being on the streets anymore than the man in the moon, because I'm not on the streets anymore. You know, when I was a kid, I could write songs like Hurt So Good, because that's what I was. I was in a band, and I was a guy in a band in a bar, and I knew what people in bars did. It'd be silly for me to try to write a song like that. I'm not in bars anymore. I was in bars every night.
When I was 18, I came on pretty strong and fast, you know. I mean, I thought I knew a lot about everything at 18. At 37, I don't know nothing about nothing or nobody, particularly me. Because older I get, the less I know. I can't understand how that works, but, you know, that surprises me. You know, that's the way it is.
She had a dream. Boy, it was a good one. So she chased after her dream with much desire. But when she got too close to her expectation, her dream burned up like paper and fire.
I'm still surprised how well it sold. To me, it was just something that had been overlooked. If we did anything, we just kind of reinvented it. You know, we just kind of stole from 40 years ago and made it, tried to figure out how to make it 1980-ish sounding.
This land is your land. This land is my land. From California to the New York Island.
You know, it all started back with Woody Guthrie and, you know, the porch music. I mean, these people were writing things that they saw and that they felt. Now everything is kind of, it's not really the art of writing songs, it's the art of making records. But I think that's what it gets down to, is the art of writing songs.
I don't make political records, you know. I get accused of that all the time, but I don't. I feel at odds with the government all the time, like I think most people do. But I don't sit down and make a political record. I guess Scarecrow was political because of that one song, Rain on the Scarecrow.
You know, and I'm sure the song's not going to change the world and make you know, it might make some people think about it a little bit.
Scarecrow on a wooden cross,
why now is so much importance put on the private sector? Why is it being passed on to us to be concerned with these people, when in reality, we voted for you guys to do what was morally right? And I think that's what the people in America are expecting. That's all I'm gonna say.
I've been involved with a lot of causes, you know, and I find most of them pretty ineffective. Unless you can totally control them and the government's not involved in it. Like this chess thing, I think we'll be successful with. I'm very optimistic about that.
Well, Chess Records is where, like, everybody from Mississippi Delta used to go up and record all these, it's basically, you know, you can say Chicago is the home of the blues, but it's the home of rock and roll. That studio was much more important, in my opinion, than Sun was. I mean, Sun made some great records, but there were just a couple artists, but Chess had so many artists go through it. And what's happening in Chicago is they were talking about tearing the building down, because there's nothing going on there. There's no equipment in there anymore. There's just a shell of the studio. The people who talked to me about it were very passionate about this can't happen. And so me seeing their passion, I was like, well, yeah, I agree. I think the thing is going to stand and they're going to make a museum out of it. And I hope that, you know, it's just right that we should do that. I mean, you know, come on, we got statues of guys in parks that we don't even know who the hell they are or what they did, you know. A lot of good records made up in that little place.
I fight, don't destroy,
I'm not that serious. I'm pretty much a practical joker type guy. You know, I like to play practical jokes on people. I'm horrible at relationships, you know. I mean, I've had two great marriages and been married to two good gals, and I've screwed both those up.
At one time, I thought, hey, I'll get stuff figured out, you know. I know what's going on. I know what to do. I know how to make this work, and how I was in control of it. Then all of a sudden, I realized I wasn't, you know, and I realized that, like you said in Big Daddy, when you live for yourself, it's hard on everybody. I didn't realize I was hard to live with. It never dawned on me. You know, the being in a bad mood and cussing and swearing and bitching to everybody would make them unhappy. Well, why? You know, but it does. Sounds so silly to say, but I didn't know that. I don't know, I'm just as scared and lonely all at the same time. The way I act works okay in the music business, but it don't work well at the house. You know, you can't treat your wife and your kids like you might treat like a booking agent or something. It's a lonely old night. Can I put my arms around you? It's a lonely old night. Just a baby too lonely, we were like me. Michelle was, she lived with me when I was living in a one-and-a-half-room cinder block house, you know, me and her mom, and when, like, the discussion was, hey, they're coming to take the phone out today, babe, I don't know what we're going to do about it. It's like, we're not home. See, she heard all those discussions as a kid. But my other kids, they don't know nothing about that kind of life. I don't know, I think with my other kids now, I'm a better father. I'm much more patient with them, you know, and see what kids are about. My youngest daughter's three, and she just thinks everybody lives this way. You know, everybody's dad's on TV, aren't they? And Teddy Joe, I think she's about the same way, too, because, you know, I'd already done all right in my field before those kids were born. I don't really even think about that kind of stuff. I mean, I don't even know if I'm famous. You know what I mean? I never even think about that crap. One time I think about it, somebody asked me for an autograph, and then I kind of go like this. What are you gonna do with it? Name three songs. Counted up the hit records we had some like, I don't know, 23 top 10 records or something. Can you imagine that? Educated in a small town, taught to fear Jesus in a small town, used to daydream in that small town, another foreign romantic, that's me. This time I really think you look at a person and you think you can size them up real quick, right? And they're sort of talking about the records that, you know, well, I've been a big fan of yours, and that Nothing Matters When It's My Favorite Record. And I would have never thought that they were even old enough to have that record, you know what I'm saying? I'm thinking I might make one of them greatest hits records or something, you know? But if I can find a better way, not a better way, but a different way of presenting the song that people are familiar with it, then we'll probably do that. We can stay out of date. We can run around all night. Well, all night. All night. Well, it's time to go home. And I ain't even done with the night. Whoa, whoa,
a little ditty about Jack and Diane. Two man kids growing up in the heartland.
But it's the whole thing of touring that scares me. I mean, I like being out in America and running around and doing all that stuff, but... And I like being... After I'm on stage, I like it, but man, there's a couple hours before and after that I just would just soon go outside and have somebody bash my brains out to do that. Because it's, I mean, it's scary to walk up in front of 18,000 people. Even I know that the people there are paying money to see me and the guys in the band, and they're there to have a good time. But what happens if I can't deliver? You know what I'm saying? And I feel like I owe it to people, you know, some guy lays out, you know, $20 for a ticket for him, and he's got a date, and he had to take the girl out to dinner, and now she wants a t-shirt, you know, and he got like $150 wrapped up in John Mellencamp. Whoa, Joe Jackson! That's a lot of responsibility for me, you know what I'm saying? For one night, there's like 18,000 of these people, got $120 wrapped up in the evening. I better be pretty damn good that night. And that's what that makes me nervous. You know, I've only been off the road from the Lonesome Jubilee Tour, not even a year yet. I mean, I'm still out playing dates this time last year. So for me to have another record out is like silly, right? But I had these songs, and you know, the band was playing well, and I knew that this was going to be the last fiddle accordion record. I wanted to make one more of those, and I had the tunes, and we were just kind of horse-assing around. We thought we were making demos, like Big Daddy was a demo at first, but then turned into the record, the song Big Daddy. So you know, I had like 15 songs. So I said, you know, we're gonna sit on them a couple of years and hope they grow or something. You know, just put them out.
Is this your life, Jackie Brown? Fully educated, forced to live on the poor side of town. Is this your daughter, Jackie Brown?
Jackie Brown, I think, might be one of the best songs I ever wrote because it's very to the point, very honest. That song's been written before, right? I think maybe I wrote it as good as anybody could write it, and that's what I like about it. No, as long as that song is how long it took me to write it. There was no malice or forethought or rewriting to it. It was just, that's the way it came out, and that's the way it stayed.
This is your family, Jack Brown. Give the cage and
honest, and it's sad, and it's happy, and it's real. It's close to the bone. Like I said, it's been written before, but I think Jackie Brown is about as good as anybody can write that story. And to me, that's an accomplishment. As a writer, I don't know. I mean, anymore. See, I just deal with a word or two, and to me, that's what it's about. I don't really try to put it in like a big, broad paragraph. I don't have to do that anymore, you know. It's about a line in a song. You know, my songs are. One line to me is the whole song. As long as I get that line in and it's effective, then the rest of it is just bull, really. And to me, it's little words. And with paintings, it's little strokes. You know, it's the little thing that makes it important. So now, I need to sit back and think about what kind of record I want to make next, because I'm not going to make that type of record anymore. Right now, I'm thinking, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, I never thought I'd be this old, you see. I never thought I'd live to be this old. As a matter of fact, we went on a camping. I got a log cabin out on this river. Me and a couple of guys, got a couple of boys, went out and did manly things like spit and cussed, you know, with our kids. And one of the guys was real excited about it. Bo, you know Bo. He was excited about it. He said, man, let's do this in 10 years. And I looked at Mark Ripley and I said, man, in 10 years we'll be 47. He said, no, in 10 years you'll be 47. I'll be dead. I don't want to live 10 more years. I thought, yeah, that's the Viking attitude. Right. Crack, boom.